It's like being on an airplane. Do I really want to go with that tiny little?
Should we start? You ready now?
You ready to go? Okay. Well, welcome everybody. My name is Joe Donlin, and I'm the Director of Outreach and Education at the Division. At the Division of Professions and Occupations. And before we get started, I just want to make sure I know that some of the people on the webinar could not hear very well at the last one. So if you can please indicate by raising your hand, if you can hear us loud and clear, we would appreciate that. Are we good? Okay. Are you okay holding that mic for?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, great. Well, this is the second stakeholder on sleep apnea, and once again, I want to just emphasize the importance of the comments you all will make and that we really appreciate you being here today. Your input will be part of the information that will ultimately be presented to the Colorado Dental Board as it considers whether to adopt a rule clarifying sleep apnea requirements or a policy to educate on the topic, or perhaps both a rule and a policy. Just a little bit about process. First, Maleed Miskell, he is the Program Director for the Colorado Dental Board, will give a quick overview of the purpose of this meeting. Mo will also introduce the presentation you will hear. But I want to be clear, I think there was some confusion at the last meeting. Both the presentation at the last meeting and today's presentation are not any type of endorsed presentation by the Colorado Dental Board. The Dental Board does not endorse either viewpoint, but wants the Dental Board's special committee to have all the information it needs to make informed decisions and recommendations to the board regarding sleep apnea. So I just want to be clear that that's why these two are presented, but they are not, neither one is favored by anyone on the Colorado Dental Board. After the presentation, you will have an opportunity to share comments in reaction to the presentation or perhaps your own views on the topic. Please refrain from asking any questions of the presenter. We have limited time and we really do need to get through everybody that would like to make comments today. If you wish to speak about the topic, please sign up on the sign-in sheets. When your name is called, please plan to come to the table and speak. If you are joining us via the webinar, you may type your comment and we can read it out loud. If you prefer to speak live and in person, just raise your hand, but do not type your comment. I will move between those who are in the room and those on the webinar. If you are making a comment, please do three things. State your name and who you represent. Provide either general comments or specific comments pertaining to sleep apnea. And as much as tempting as it may be, please try not to repeat. We very much appreciate if someone has made the exact statements you would make and you agree and you state that for the record, and that will certainly be recorded and given to the board. Each stakeholder will have 3 minutes to speak. For those in the room, I will flash a card to signal when you have a minute left and again at 30 seconds. For those on the webinar, I will gently interrupt since you can't see my cards. As far as ground rules, please step into the hallway for any sidebar discussions or phone calls. Please put any phones on vibrate or please turn them off. And please keep your comments related to the dental professional's role and the physician's role in sleep apnea treatment and the need, if there is one, for regulations and or policies related to that role. Also, this goes without saying, but please be courteous, professional, and respectful of everyone's viewpoints shared today. After all of the comments are made, the committee will have a meeting. At that time, after all comments, we will take a 2-minute break after the final comments are made. This will allow those who do not want to stay for the committee meeting to leave. I know at the last one, we sort of got going real fast and then everybody had to herd out or exit off the webinar. So this way, we'll give a short break for those who want to leave, and then we'll proceed with the committee meeting. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Mo.
Hi, good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for taking the time to come in today. For those of you here in person and those are on the webinar, thank you for logging in. It's greatly appreciated. And also for those that have already submitted written comments over the last couple of weeks, that's also greatly appreciated. All that information will be considered by the committee, has been considered by the committee, and will continue to be considered by the committee and ultimately the board. And I'm not going to thank everybody in person. The list is quite long, but believe me, they've all been responded to, and I've thanked them all individually. And so today, once again, picking up where we left off last time, is really to hear from you. We're going to start off with a presentation again for about 30 minutes. We're going to avoid the Q&A session this time, since that devolved into something unintended last time. And so if Dr. Bailey's interested and willing to provide his contact information and anybody has a question for him, hopefully you can communicate directly and keep the board and myself out of it. But with that being said, when you're thinking about, when you're listening to Dr. Bailey speak, just think about a few things. Think about, is this something that really truly needs to be clarified by the dental board? That's who we are here today to discuss is the dental board, not the medical board. That's a different topic altogether. We do have a representative for the medical board on this committee. But think about if the dental board itself needs to clarify sleep apnea in some way, and if so, how? Would that be in the form of a rule, a policy, or both? What the dental board cannot do is rewrite the statute. So just keep that in mind. So there are some inherent limitations in statute that you're concerned about. This is the wrong body to be addressing on that issue. The folks at the Capitol is who you want to speak to. And their session, I think, is almost done, so you might be late this year. But there's always next year. So with that being said, Dr. Bailey, thank you for taking the time today to speak to us. If you could just keep it to 30 minutes, it'd be greatly appreciated. And so for those that don't know, Dr. Bailey is co-director at the Sleep Medicine Mini Residency at UCLA School of Dentistry. He introduced himself at the last meeting, and he was very much interested in presenting to us today, and we thought it would be fair to provide a different perspective compared to what we heard last week. So Dr. Bailey, the floor is yours, sir.
Thank you. What I want to do is try to cover the role of the dentist in sleep medicine as well as in oral appliance therapy, and I apologize that I can't look around and do this at the same time. This is something that I've focused on for much of my career. The role of the dentist, as published in JATA in 2010, showed that 65% of adults age 18 to 65 and 58% of adults greater than 65 visit the dentist during a 12-month period. And this increases the exposure of these patients to being screened and the risk for sleep apnea or sleep breathing disorder being discovered. The dentist is an important access point for identification and treatment of OSA, and this was a poster presentation that got published in Sleep and Breathing back in 2007. The dentist's role in healthcare is becoming more and more of a positive effect. We have a major role in recognizing health-related disorders. We're not making a diagnosis. We're looking for risk. And I like to use the phrases that when a patient tells you something that tends to imply that they may have the risk for something that their history is consistent with or they are at risk for, to clarify making or trying to state that we are making a diagnosis. And I think these two phrases, from more or less of a medical legal point of view, really uncover what the role of the dentist is when it comes to, and specifically in the sleep breathing, sleep apnea realm. Once recognized, then develop a management plan, which may include consultation and referral, either with a medical doctor, the primary care doctor, the sleep doctor, whoever it may be that's important to this patient's ultimate diagnosis. Examples that I'd like to give are oral facial pain, which I've been involved in now for some 40 years. And orofacial pain involves more than just TMJ or TMD as it's sometimes called. These can be neuropathic disorders, these can be intracranial disorders, they can be disorders of the jaw and so forth. And many of these patients develop insomnia because of these pain conditions. It's sort of a bi-directional relationship that exists. Management of sleep disorders, typically with an oral appliance when there is a sleep breathing disorder, yes, that falls within the realm of the dental profession, as is outlined in the clinical guidelines paper as well as the practice parameters from 2006. But what is a sleep breathing disorder? Well, you know, if you really look at it from infancy to adolescence to adulthood, the sleep breathing disorder really begins with something as simplistic as just being a mouth breather. A patient who is just mouth breathing and is unable to breathe through the nose or by obligation breathes through the mouth oftentimes will suffer some of the same types of symptoms that a patient who is a true snorer or sleep apneic might have. So we have to keep that in mind in terms of what we're dealing with. Last time we were here a week and a half ago on the 31st, Sam Callender brought that to light about the orthodontist and their increasing awareness of the airway and how the airway is implicated. Sleep apnea screening for dentists. This is from an abstract at the sleep meeting in Utah back in 2006, 11 years ago. But they saw that 95% of sleep apnea patients are undiagnosed. Now, at this present time, according to Frost and Sullivan, a recent report released by the American Academy of Sleep Medicine, it's now estimated to be 80%. But that's a large number. That's a big number in the population that are undiagnosed. And what's kind of striking is it's greater than that in terms of the number that have been diagnosed but are actually adequately being managed. And I focus on the word manage because I don't like the word treatment. This is a management. In other words, when you manage something, there's going to be ongoing potential for exacerbation of the same type of thing that was originally diagnosed. So you're not treating it, implying that you're curing it or getting it better. What you're doing is you're trying to keep it in check. Sleep disorders dentists see as many patients as GP physicians, so the dentists are well qualified to be screening for the patients who are at risk. And dentists play an increasing role in recognition and diagnosis of sleep apnea. And it's interesting that this paper is from 2006 because the February 2006 publication of the practice parameters for oral appliances was in the journal Sleep that February. And they kind of parallel one another in terms of what their roles are and how they come together. The role of the dentist I've often looked at as being indirect and direct. In other words, in an indirect fashion, the dentist is recognized that there's a sleep disorder and educates the patient, makes the proper referral. As was mentioned, I co-direct a program at UCLA. We have many dentists who come to our program who blatantly say, I'm not really interested in doing this. I want to learn more about it so that I can help my patients get to the right place because so far they're not getting there. And then we have the direct approach. And the direct approach is similar to the indirect approach. However, the dentist now becomes involved in the actual treatment and management of that patient over the long term. And that's key, long term. This is not something where we do something, we do a restoration, or we put a crown on and it's done. This is something that's ongoing, sort of like monitoring or managing periodontal disease. Well, this is what a dentist sees every day. I hate to use the quote, they're down in the mouth, but you know, basically they're looking in the oral cavity every day and seeing a lot of things other than just the teeth and the gingival structures and the tongue, but they're looking back into the oral pharyngeal area at the soft palate, at the uvula, and they have the opportunity to begin to uncover many things that would indicate that a patient's at risk for a sleep breathing disorder. And this is a list. I'm not going to read it to you. You can read it for yourself. But many of these things are common things that the dentist deals with on an ongoing daily basis. Some of us more than others, granted, depending upon the slant of our practice, but we all see these things on an ongoing basis. Well, I want to call your attention to this because this is one of the things that dentists see on a regular basis and sometimes make claims as to what it is, but is the accuracy there? This is tongue scalloping or crenations where the outlines of the posterior teeth are marked in the tongue, and you can see how they're well indented here along the lateral border of the tongue. Well, interestingly, in an article in Otolaryngology Head and Neck Surgery back in 2005, they found that in patients who had been diagnosed with sleep apnea, this scalloping of the tongue showed a 71% specificity for decreased sleep efficiency. In other words, they didn't sleep as well. 70% specific for abnormal AHI. 86% specific for a decreased oxygen saturation of greater than 4%. And the presence and severity correlated with what's called the Mallampati score, which is kind of a standard bearer of trying to determine who may or may not be at risk for a sleep breathing disorder. And speaking of that, here it is. This is a modified Mallampati score called the Friedman tongue position. This was developed by Michael Friedman, who's an ear, nose, and throat physician at Rush Memorial in Chicago. He's published extensively on sleep breathing disorders from the ENT perspective. He's written a textbook on surgical procedures for sleep apnea. And what you see here is you go from FTP, that stands for Friedman tongue position, from 1 to 2A to 2B, and then you go, excuse me, to 3 and 4. You can see the tongue continues to obliterate an open view of the oral pharyngeal structures. And as we go from 1 to 2 to 3 to 4, similar to what the Mallampati score is, we know now that in a 3 and 4 situation, this patient's at greater risk for a sleep breathing disorder. It also indicates this patient may have more difficulty tolerating either an oral appliance or maybe even CPAP. Well, Mallampati score has been found to predict sleep apnea. For every 1 point increase in the score, in other words, going from 1 to 2 to 3 to 4, there's a twofold increase in the risk for OSA. So it's also for every 1 point increase in AHI, increases 5 events per hour. So severity has been sort of linked to the severity or the amount of Mallampati score by 1 to 4. Results are independent of airway anatomy and BMI, meaning the amount of obesity or overweight nature of the patient, as well as their medical history. And this was published in the journal Sleep. And again, 2006 pops up. Well, guidelines specific to oral appliance therapy, as I mentioned, are the practice parameters from 2006, and then the recent clinical practice guidelines from the ASM and the AADSM. That's American Academy of Sleep Medicine, American Academy of Dental Sleep Medicine. They're basically two joined organizations or linked organizations that deals principally with treating sleep breathing disorders and specifically sleep apnea and snoring. And this guideline came out in 2015 as a way of trying to update the report from 2006. I don't want to go into the details of this. It kind of gives indications for when oral appliances are recommended. It's worthwhile that anyone who's looking at this field specifically have an opportunity to review these two papers in detail. I feel the practice parameter is a little bit more descriptive than the clinical guidelines. The clinical guidelines tends to be just that, a guideline, so the evidence is not as significant as it was in the practice parameter paper. Well, there is a crossover between medicine and dentistry, and I'm going to give you some examples. Sleep bruxism, a movement disorder. Now, every dentist deals with bruxism. Dentists make bite splints for people or night guards for people who grind their teeth. But many dentists don't realize that in the International Classification of Sleep Disorders, this is actually classified as a movement disorder, like restless leg or periodic limb movement. And so it's now called sleep bruxism, and I'll show you the actual categorization of it. Orofacial pain, not just TMD and TMJ, such as headache, neuropathic pain, muscular pain, or myalgia. And then I want to look at periodontal disease. Well, there are inflammatory markers associated with many of these disorders that I just mentioned. And the inflammatory markers are increased in those with OSA. So, but what is OSA? Well, is it really the sleep apnea, or is it hypoxia, or is it both? That's something that needs to be basically fended out in a sleep study or in a pulse oximetry study. And these markers that I've got listed, tumor necrosis factor alpha, interleukin-6, C-reactive protein, IL-8, all of these are related to hypoxia and what's called oxidative stress. And oxidative stress is important because it's kind of the forerunner of cardiovascular disease. It has an implication in periodontal disease. So here's where we're crossing over between medicine and dentistry. Now, this is a panoramic x-ray, familiar to every dentist in the room, but maybe not to physicians. But what I want to point out to you is look here. You see these calcifications here, and then over here on this side as well, the calcifications? Those are calcifications that are appearing in the carotid artery and typically can occur, now don't always, but can occur in patients who have sleep apnea. These are atherosclerotic plaques that can develop. There was an article in the journal Sleep some years ago entitled Not So Good Vibrations, and it talked about how snoring, no matter what degree, how heavy, can actually, through by vibration, cause the aggregation, platelet aggregation of these plaques. And that goes along with what I showed before in terms of the oxidative stress. So every dentist who takes a panoramic x-ray, no matter what age the patient, you can find these plaques in some patients which should signal that this patient is at risk. Now, if these break free, that's a bad thing because they're going to go only one way, and that's north. Now, the other thing is, this is an interesting paper. It's from 2001, so it's pretty old, but it still has merit because this was published by the National Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute, and it looks at cardiovascular and sleep-related consequences of TMJ disorders. And this was a paper that was done by a number of physicians, a few dentists, but mostly physicians, some very noteworthy physicians in the sleep world. And they found there were comorbid complaints, such as problems with sleep, blood pressure, and breathing, not uncommon for this group of TMD patients. So my point is, there are dentists out there on a daily basis treating TMD, treating TMJ, treating bruxism. And what they may have is a subtle, undiagnosed or unrecognized sleep apnea patient because many of the symptoms can be very similar. This is some of the reporting. I don't have it all on here, but these patients exhibit sleep dysfunction associated with persistent pain. It's associated with increased tendency to back sleep, so they have to stay off the side, or they tend to stay off their side. Effects of acute and persistent pain upon autonomic and motor control impose cardiovascular increased risk. And increased mandibular movement contributes to gene and glossus activity. And so we see that there's some tongue muscle activity that can be associated with it. The point is that this is a paper from 2001 that clearly shows that there is a crossover between medicine and dentistry in terms of TMD, sleep disordered breathing, OSA, however you want to phrase it. Well, a paper in, again, 2006. Funny how that number keeps popping up. But here's sleep loss, REM sleep loss and pain. And this showed that a loss of 4 hours of sleep and specifically REM sleep deprivation led to increased hyperalgesia the next day. And this is what we typically see in pain patients. These pain patients who don't sleep as well, they don't tend to get into the normal routine of their sleep cycles, can have an exacerbation of their pain upon awakening. The key points is the sleep loss increases pain, and medications that decrease sleep may actually increase their pain. So all of these things are coming together. And I guess the thing that's probably most striking that isn't on the slide is the opioid crisis. Because with the opioid crisis, opioids do suppress respiration. There is an increased tendency for central sleep apnea with opioids. And of course, in the United States, opioid use is virtually out of control. And so we need to be aware of that as well. OSA and periodontal disease. Now, every dentist every dentist in the world is treating periodontal disease, whether they treat it themselves within their office, or their hygienist is treating it, or they're referring it out to a periodontist. Well, what's interesting here in this Journal of Periodontal Research from a few years ago, 687 patients, 46.6% of them had OSA, 60% with periodontitis had OSA, and they looked at a high AHI, apnea hypopnea index, mouth breathing during sleep, smoking, and male prevalence. The point is that we go back to some of those inflammatory markers. They're the same markers in periodontal disease that you will find in these OSA patients or in these sleep breathing disordered patients. And then in the journal Sleep last year, or 2 years ago now, periodontitis and sleep disordered breathing, a large Hispanic population was looked at between the ages of 18 and 74. And out of these three groups, non-OSA, subclinical or mild, and moderate to severe, they found to be 40% greater in subclinical, 60% greater in mild, and 50% greater in moderate. So C-reactive protein, again, was elevated in this group of patients. Therapeutic effects of melatonin on alveolar resorption. Again, Journal of Periodontology. Many patients are taking melatonin over-the-counter to help with their sleep, just on their own fruition. And these patients are using these medications.
Hello. So
we know that this was a rat study, but it showed that it had the ability as an anti-inflammatory to actually improve alveolar bone in patients with periodontal disease. So now you've got a group of patients who are periodontally unstable, patients who have active disease, and every periodontist will tell you these patients are very difficult to control. And so what happens is that are we dealing with the thing that's really at play? Could it be that there's an underlying sleep apnea problem or a hypoxic problem that's lending itself to this ongoing unremitting periodontal disease? And that's something where, again, it starts to cross over between medicine and dentistry. Periodontal disease and Alzheimer's. This is from PLOS. This was published a year ago. And it showed that there's a rise in pro-inflammatory cytokines. They saw elevated antibodies to periodontal disease. And so the presence of periodontal baseline, not related to cognitive decline, but there was a six-fold increase in the rate of cognitive decline. So again, another study showing that we've got things that are similar to OSA, similar to hypoxia, that are also showing up in a periodontally involved population. So the dentist is very much on board with, if they understand this, to be able to help their patients in every way possible. Sleep bruxism is another category. I'm not going to read the slide to you, but this slide is basically out of the International Classification of Disease, and you can see there's an ICD-10 code for sleep bruxism in the medical literature. The bottom line is that there is diagnostic criteria related to sleep bruxism. It is considered to be a medical disorder because many of the same symptoms that patients with sleep bruxism have, OSA patients have. And so there's a distinct crossover that may exist between these patients. I'm not going to say every bruxing patient has sleep apnea or snores. That's ludicrous. But there is an increased tendency or increased risk for these patients to be affected. Teeth grinding is linked to sleep apnea. This was presented at the annual meeting, the CHEST meeting in 2009 by the then president of the organization. It was a study out of Baylor University. And he showed that 1 in 4 with OSA also have nocturnal bruxism. Study at Baylor with 300 people said 25.6 have bruxism, and of those, 35% actually had acid reflux. And there has been some things in the literature tying bruxism with right reflux with OSA. A lot of connections that are trying to be made or attempted to be made, but are still somewhat totally unsubstantiated. Now, SSRIs, a medication that many patients are on for depression and other types of disorders psychiatrically as well as psychologically, is well documented. And this medication, these SSRIs, are known to increase the rate of bruxism in these patients. So that's another thing that the dentist needs to be aware of. The risk of aggravation of sleep apnea with an occlusal splint. Now, this is a very small study conducted at the University of Montreal, but this study was presented at the IADR in March of 2004, and it showed that of the 10 patients, four patients developed more severe apnea with their bite splint. And I see this every day, where patients come in, they have a bite splint, and it's actually causing more retrognathia of the mandible, more of a retrusion of the tongue into the airway space, which is probably precipitating a worsened OSA situation. And the AHI could increase by as much as 50%. So the conclusion is, question patients about sleep-related breathing disorders prior to any splint therapy. Let's make sure we're doing the right appliance for these people and getting them in the right channel for testing as well as for treatment. So what I want to do now, in conclusion, is just present a few case reports. What I did was rounded up of just three reports from our office to show you what can be expected with oral appliance therapy. This is both my patients as well as Dr. Smith's patients, and so you'll get an idea of what's going on. And this is with the use of an oral appliance or mandibular repositioner. And I just want to call your attention to the term I have at the bottom. I think that's a really good term because there's too many differing terms that float around about what are these devices called, MADs, MRDs, oral appliances, dental appliances. I got a referral from a pulmonologist some years ago, and he called it an oral OSA device. I thought that was a unique description for these oral appliances. So case one is a patient who's 46 at the start, now 47. The chief complaint was snoring, witnessed apneas, wakes up gasping, sore throat in the AM, and headaches 2 to 3 times a week. All very common symptoms of a patient who's at risk for sleep apnea. The Epworth Sleepiness Scale score, for those of you who don't know, is a measure of how sleepy or drowsy a patient might be in sedentary situations like driving, sitting at a movie or a theater, sitting talking to someone after lunch, and so forth. At the start was 9 at the sleep center and 5 in the office. The stop bang, which is also a type of screening mechanism to look at how much the patient may be at risk for sleep apnea, which was instituted by Dr. Chung, who's an anesthesiologist, to use pre-screening for anesthesia for risk of OSA. That score was 7. The patient was unable to tolerate the CPAP, hence he was non-adherent to the therapy. Now, in there are two terms, intolerance and non-adherent, and I think it's important to distinguish those because we often confuse them. A patient who is intolerant is continually trying to use the device, the CPAP, but may not be able to use it on a regular basis for a wide variety of reasons. A patient who's non-adherent has been prescribed the CPAP, knows they should be using it, and just refuses to do so. There are a lot of patients who are non-adherent with their medications, whether it be blood pressure, cholesterol, or diabetes, and so the two terms really do mean something different. So sleep study results in January of 2015 showed the patient had an AHI of 86.9, quite severe. Supine AHI went up to 102, so if the patient got on the back, this was the AHI went up significantly. Average oxygen was 88%. He started on an oral appliance therapy and follow-up testing was done in October of 2015. The results showed that the apnea hypopnea index had been lowered from 86 to 13.3. A fairly significant improvement. The patient went from very severe to mild. Average oxygen was now 90%, so it improved by 2 points. Future, in terms of what this patient may also require for the future, is weight loss, investigate the RLS and PLMs, that is the restless leg and periodic limb movements, although the iron and ferritin levels were reported as normal. Iron and ferritin are two tests that can be done because they've been shown when they're low to be linked to RLS and PLMs. Second patient, MC, patient started at age 53, the patient is now 55. Chief complaint was chronic migraine headaches. He was referred because some neurologists who treat migraine or primary care doctors may think that the migraines are made worse by the sleep breathing disorder, so they send the patient for a sleep study to determine if, in fact, this may be part of what's going on. Tired during the day, the Epworth Sleepiness Scale score was only 6. Normally, it has to be in double digits to be indicative of a very tired patient, and there was snoring. The AHI at the onset was 14.2, so it was mild, approaching a moderate, and oxygen saturation was under 88% for 6% of the time from this home sleep test that he had. Patient declined CPAP, not interested, and was referred for an oral appliance. Follow-up HST, oral appliance was subsequently done. Patient was followed up with an HST, home sleep test, was done December of 2016. And his AHI now was 2.2, so went from 14 down to 2.2 in the normal range. Was supine 85% of the time. So whether he got on his back or not, the overall AHI had improved significantly. Oxygen saturation was 89 to 91% when non-supine and 89 to 90% if he got on his back. The ODI, which is a measure of the desaturation index for oxygen, at the start was 7.0 and with the oral appliance was 3.1. So he wasn't desaturating as much either, which is a key finding related to other types of oxidative stress type bodily functions. And then case 3, this is the last one, is patient CG. Patient was age 47 at the start in the mid-2015s. The chief complaint was snoring, headaches, tired during the day, and low energy levels. Poor executive function, had difficulty with memory, concentration, making decisions, drowsy driving, acid reflux or GERD, and sleep bruxism. The Epworth Sleepiness Scale score was 14, but the stop bang was only 3. The HST was done June 2015. The AHI was 14.6. Oxygen saturation below 90% for 3.8% of the time and below 88 for only 0.6% of the time. No CPAP trial. PCP gave her a choice of the CPAP or oral appliance. Started the oral appliance therapy in August of 2015. A follow-up home sleep test was done in March of 2017. The patient's apnea hypopnea index was now 5.8, and the oxygen desaturation index was 7. The sleep medicine physician, who's been co-managing the patient with me, felt the oral appliance was adequate. It was adequately controlling the patient's sleep apnea and just said, continue to do what you're doing. Subjectively, the Epworth sleepiness score is now 9. It went down into single digits. Not feeling tired, no headaches now. The acid reflux is better controlled. She's sleeping better and feels more rested. So the plan is just monitor this patient on an annual basis. So there are many positive effects of oral appliances that can be done. I don't disagree that there are people out there who are simply placing an appliance for no good reason other than the patient complains of snoring or may have a diagnosis of sleep apnea, but the follow-up is where the key is. That's the key to the whole thing. So the takeaway message is oral appliances can be successful. They do require titration and adjustment. This is something that is more than what the CPAP gets, that the oral appliances oftentimes will require anywhere from 3 to 6 months over a period of maybe 2 to 4 visits to get this adjusted for comfort and for maximum or optimum effect. And this is to find what I call the sweet spot, the place where the patient feels the oral appliance is functioning as optimally as it possibly can. and reduce any side effects such as bite problems, jaw pain, or other things. The biggest issues, outcome management, improve their nasal breathing, which is critical to making these appliances work well. It's also critical to making CPAP much more effective, and residual insomnia once the oral appliance is working well. That has been published extensively. Many of these patients present with insomnia after the oral appliance has been shown to be working well because they were so sleep disrupted throughout the period of time that they were using the appliance that the insomnia piece is no longer resolved. And so the dentist needs to be savvy to the insomnia, why the insomnia is there, and what to do to help the patient, whether it's cognitive behavioral therapy or referring back to their physician for treatment. Cognitive behavioral therapy isn't provided by us. It's provided by a therapist or someone who's well-trained in it. There are also a growing number of internet programs for cognitive behavioral therapy. So I like to end with the phrase John Wooden had. Being a UCLA guy, I was a big fan of John's. Things turn out best for the people who make the best of the way things turn out. So we are always going to get hit with some little sidebar of things. Something's going to go awry. But the adequately and qualified trained dentist who's involved in this field of oral appliance therapy for sleep breathing disorders will be able to make the best of the way things turn out once they understand what's going on with the patient. I thank you very much for the time. I hope this gave you a positive look and positive insight into the dentist's role and some of the things dentistry has to offer in this field and the co-relationship, the bi-directional relationship that exists between medicine and dentistry and is growing precipitously. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Bailey, and truly appreciate you going under 30 minutes. There was a lot to cover, and you did it quickly and efficiently. So we're going to turn over to comments. Were there any people raising their hands on the webinar? And while we're getting ready for that, do you want to put that up there so we can see, so Joe can see? People raising their hands for comments? And while you're doing that,
I'll just look to Dan.
Okay. We'll start with the room first.
Yep. Absolutely. Okay. And Dr. Bailey, you're welcome to stay there, or if you want to go more into the audience, or just greet whoever comes and hits in the hot seat. The first person we will have is Dr. Sklovsky. Did I pronounce that correctly? Okay. Please come to the chair so that everyone can see you, hear you in the microphone. This way everyone in the webinar can hear everything, all the comments, much more efficiently. But please go ahead. You have 3 minutes.
So I'm Dr. Victoria Sklovsky. I'm a diplomate in dental sleep medicine, and I'm treating so many patients with oral appliances very successfully with a great result. So when the patients go in for the sleep study, so the result is no sleep apnea events.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for joining us today. The next person is Lori Schmidt. Lori, if you'll come and please state your name and who you represent. And you'll have 3 minutes.
Okay. I'm Lori Schmidt, and I'm a speaker with Sleep Group Solutions, and I'm also a medical biller, and I'm a 30-year dental assistant. And I worked in a busy dental practice here in Denver, and I was a sleep care coordinator. And now I bill for about 25 dentists in the Denver, or the actual all Colorado and California. So I represent a lot of them. But I just have a few things. I listened in on the webinar last week, and in that, you know, I just really feel that this is all about, we really just need to save lives. First and foremost, this is not about competition. We, you know, as Dr. Bailey, I agreed with so much of what he said. We're looking in the patient's mouth. We see all of these symptoms. We're looking at health histories. We're following these patients twice a year. We have a rapport with these patients. We get to spend a little bit extra time with them. When a patient goes to their physician, they usually get a small amount of time to spend with the physician. And if they come in for a cold and then they say, well, I also have this issue, I usually have to make another appointment. So I just really feel that I think there's a great opportunity to work well together. I think that I believe there's only one state in the country, and that's New Jersey, that does not allow home sleep testing to be implemented by the dentist or by to be requested by the dentist. And many patients just won't. If you refer them, you know, you say you need to go to Swedish, you need to go to Jewish. I used to, when I did refer patients, or we did refer patients out, sometimes it would be 45 to even longer, 45 days or even longer before they could get in. And so we really need to screen these patients and get them tested and diagnosed. I don't agree that the dentist should do the diagnosis, and that should be left to the board certified sleep physician. You know, when I do lecture, we never bash CPAP. We congratulate patients on wearing CPAP if they're able to comply. But compliance is, I believe, 4 hours of night, 4 hours each night for, I think, 4 days a week, and that's considered compliant with CPAP therapy. I don't think you get to pick which 4 hours. You're not apneic in the evening, and it's very dangerous. And most apneas happen during REM sleep, and a lot of patients will get up in the middle of the night and take their CPAP off and not put it back on. Most REM sleep happens towards morning, and so it's a very dangerous time to be without your CPAP. Education is key, and I do the two-day seminars. Am I out?
You're out. Okay. You can finish your thought.
Oh, I believe that we need to educate our patients. So my recommendation is that I think we should require more CE credits for dentists that are going to be treating sleep apnea. And I thank you for your time.
Thank you very much for being here today. Do we have anyone? Let's see, I'll go to the next one that says possibly right here. It is Dan Selner.
I'm good. Thank you.
Okay. Is there anyone, while we're adjusting the microphone, is there anyone else in the room that would like to make a comment? Okay. Dan, is there anyone on the webinar that would like to make a comment?
There is somebody that put in a question.
Okay.
This is Adam Woods. He says, Dr. Bailey.
He says, Dr. Bailey, thank you for your presentation. Given the information presented by both Dr. Hickey and Dr. Bailey, I think it is clear that there is no doubt a role for both the dentist and physician in treating OSA. However, they both also make it clear that treating OSA is a complex matter strongly associated with other medical disorders. As a result, I think the board strongly needs to consider requiring that dentists who provide oral appliance therapy to patients in the state of Colorado have additional and proper training to do so. Specifically, the board should consider mandating dentists be a diplomat of the American Academy of Dental Sleep Medicine and or complete a mini fellowship program in dental sleep medicine. If this is not required, patients will continue to receive inadequate care from unqualified dentists. If a dentist wants to treat OSA with oral appliance therapy, then they should have no problem seeking out the additional training necessary to properly perform such a therapy. Adam Wertz, Colorado Sleep Institute.
Are there any more?
May I address that?
Sure. Saying that one organization has the authority to be the only sanctioning body is ludicrous. In a field that has no specialty. The specialty that exists currently by CODA standards is orofacial pain. And orofacial pain a la CODA, if you look at the CODA document, it's on page 8 and page 12, I believe, and I gave you a copy of that, basically states that the training of an orofacial pain dentist, that is someone who treats oral facial pain, head and neck pain, requires certain amount or certain level of training, which is what we provide at UCLA and many other institutions around the country do, that basically indicates that these people are equally trained and in some regards better trained than saying that one organization rides roughshod over this whole body or this whole discipline. The bottom line is that the AADSM initiated this year or last year a qualified dentist program. The qualified dentist program is ludicrous because all you have to be is a member to sign up to say that you are qualified. And that is regardless of the number of hours of training. The number of hours of training, I agree, have to be a certain number that's determined by a governing body, whether it's a state board, whether it's like Texas did. Texas's state board said all the dentist needed was 12 hours. That's about half of what the AADSM says. That's way under what we provide at UCLA in our sleep mini residency. So the fact of the matter is you can't go by one governing board or governing body. You have to look at all of the organizations because there are other organizations besides that are out there. The American Academy of Cranial Facial Pain has a dental sleep medicine board that they give where they have diplomate status. The American Academy of Sleep Breathing Disorders has a board that they give. Whether they're reputable or not is immaterial. The fact of the matter is there are other organizations providing what is considered to be a board examination that may or may not be prudent in terms of indicating someone has the credentials or qualifications to do it. And therefore, I think that to insist that the Colorado State Board look at one organization to be the governing organization is eliminating a large number of people who are equally well qualified but may have gotten their qualifications from other learned institutions.
Is there anyone else on the webinar? Was there anyone else on the webinar that
wanted to? I can't really hear you.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank Joe.
Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Bailey, for that. Also, it's important to remember in Colorado, unlike some states, we don't have specialty licenses, right? We have one license to practice in Colorado, and the way the law is written, if you have the education, training, experience to practice that aspect of dentistry, you're allowed to do so. And of course, everyone has varying levels of education, experience, and training to do so. We don't have requirements that outline exactly what you need for implants, just like we don't for endo, just like we don't for a variety of different dental treatment that dentists provide in the state of Colorado. So it's just important to remember that. And so with that being said...
Dan, did anybody else come forward on the webinar real quick? He's just taking one more look. At this point, I want to thank everyone on the webinar and in the room for participating. The committee will now formally discuss stakeholder input and its recommendations to the board. If you do not care to stay or listen to the discussion on the webinar, please take this opportunity to leave now, and we will reconvene the committee discussion in just a few minutes.
Yeah.
Can I go home now?
Yes, we can hear you, Dave.
Can I go home now?
Oh, no. No. Let's try.
Hey, Mo, this is Donna.
Yes.
Hey, when we reconvene, will you just let us know who's in the room and who's still on the webinar? That would be helpful for me. I don't know if it's helpful for Dave.
You mean provide their names? Or
it's helpful for me to whoever's speaking to introduce themselves.
Gotcha. Yes.
Hey, this is Donna Baldwin. I was just suggesting that it would be nice to know who's remaining in the room and on the webinar. Or does that not matter? Or if maybe people are just talking, they do what Dave said. That would be helpful too.
Yeah, I think, Donna, it'll be probably easier if we just do the latter. If anybody wants to speak, we'll just make them identify themselves. There's about 6-7 people in the room. How many people are on the webinar? And there are 31 on the webinar. So listing them all out would probably not.
That's perfect.
Okay.
It's just nice to have an idea.
Absolutely. So we still have packed house, so to speak. Nothing like it was a week and a half ago, but still quite a few people left that are interested in hearing your deliberations. So what we have in front of us, and for those on the webinar also, is draft rules that we took a crack at. This is a draft. It should clearly say draft, although this copy does not show it. But trust me, it is a draft. And as you can see, there's X's where it mentions potentially amended date and effective date that shows you it's a draft. This is just a working product as a starting point for this group to review and to give me direction on what it's thinking based on all the feedback and stakeholder input received up to this point. So hopefully you guys have had a chance to digest and have a lot to talk me through. And of course, the folks in the room will have an opportunity also to provide input if they're interested in doing so, as well as the folks on the webinar. So you should be able to see it on the webinar, just like as you can see it on the two screens here in this room. Anyone on the committee want to start? I see Sue has taken some furious notes. Did you want to start?
You want me to talk about my comments on the regulations? Okay, this is Sue Warren. I'm a board member. I was just going to ask you where you got your definition, Mo, for obstructive sleep apnea.
I made it up. I took a bunch of different pieces of literature that were sent to us that I reviewed and cobbled together this definition. I'm not at all married to it, but it is a combination of a variety of different sources. So it didn't come from one source.
Okay. That was just something I wanted to know. The definition looks okay to me. I'd be curious to hear if anyone in the audience or on the webinar have a problem with the definition, and if so, what it is. But I didn't have one.
Can everybody read it in the room? Have they had a chance to digest it? Anyone on the webinar? Dr. Thurgood? Dr. Baldwin? Baldwin? Sarah? Dr. Butler? Yes, sir. Come on up.
My name is Chris Baird. I'm a dentist here in Denver. Just a quick question for you on the definition. Going down to that second part, A1, where a dentist shall screen for sleep apnea utilizing the tools recommended by the American Academy of Sleep Medicine and or the AADSM. Did they have a specific definition? So if one of the thoughts is that we're going to potentially go down that road of kind of following some of their recommendations, do they have a specific definition of sleep apnea?
I don't recall. There's a variety of groups that had pieces of what appeared to be a definition. But I don't remember anyone had like a nice complete definition, and they had all sorts of information. So they would say sleep apnea has this, and they just keep going, sometimes a whole page. So I try to condense it. And so just to clarify, the definition's at the top, right? But if you think there's a source that has a perfect definition, a nice, succinct definition that covers what obstructive sleep apnea is, I'd be more than willing to entertain it. Two hands up on the webinar. Excellent. Elmer? Who? Elmer?
Yes. And,
could you identify yourself first?
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. We just need you to identify who you are and who you represent before you make your comment.
Yes, my name is Elmer Villalon. I'm a dentist in Pueblo. Essentially represent solely my business. And the with respect to Rule 1 definitions, 1, obstructive sleep apnea is a common sleep-related, that should be, I would think, breathing disorder as opposed to a sleep-related disorder. And just add breathing. After related, add breathing.
Is that what you said? Like that?
Yes, that's my comment, sir.
Thank you for that. Jeffrey Lodi?
Yeah, Jeffrey Lodi. I believe there's actually a very specific definition in medicine of sleep apnea that requires a 10-second pause in their breathing and a 4% desaturation of their oxygen level. So I think if you're talking about OSA, there is actually a very specific criteria that has to be met. Hypopnea, not so much. So that's my comment about that one.
And where?
Thank you.
Where is this definition located? Sorry, sir.
From the seminars I've gone to, which have been multiple, I believe it requires a 10-second cessation of their breathing and a 4% desaturation of their oxygen level to actually qualify to be obstructive sleep apnea.
Gotcha. And you think the definition?
Less than that would be in the hypopnea mode.
Okay. I did see that.
If it's less than 10 seconds, then it's not going to be apnea. It's going to be hypopnea. Or if they have less than a 4%, if they only have a 3% desaturation, it's actually going to be hypopnea, not apnea.
Okay.
So the apnea has a specific definition, I believe. And that's the criteria that I remember that will qualify it as being OSA.
Correct. The comment here was, because we did see that, but that was getting into the specifics of a diagnostic criteria versus a general definition. Is how it was viewed. But thank you for your comment. We'll definitely take a look at it again.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else, Dan? Adam Wirtz.
This is Adam Wirtz, Colorado Sleep Institute. Just to follow up on that previous comment, he is essentially defining how you score associated events with obstructive sleep apnea. So for example, 4% DSAT rules associated with apneas, hypopneas have a different rule, respiratory effort related arousals have a different rule. Those are rules specifically how to define a specific event within obstructive sleep apnea. All three of those types of breathing events comprise obstructive sleep apnea. So I don't think you need to go into that much detail as far as defining each type of respiratory event within obstructive sleep apnea, because as you said, you are just summarizing obstructive sleep apnea as a general definition, not essentially the components of the disorder itself.
Great, thank you. While you're looking at the definition that we have, though, as a draft, do you think it's an adequate definition? Do you think anything's missing? Did you like the version of breathing?
I think it's an adequate definition. I think that, there, like you mentioned, there are tons of different resources for definition of obstructive sleep apnea. I think that if you really want to look it up, you could go to the ICD-10 has a specific definition of obstructive sleep apnea that medical practices use. That would be another resource to look at. But I don't see anything wrong with how you're defining it. It's just a basic condition that is defined as repetitive narrowing and collapsing of the upper airway. So there's nothing incorrect with what you're saying, put it that way.
Okay. Well, thank you, sir. Community members, anyone have any comments about the?
Yeah, this is Donna Baldwin with the Colorado Medical Board. What my only suggestion, and I kind of echo what the last person was talking about with regards to, you don't really want to put a diagnostic definition on there. I think you want to be pretty general. Otherwise, then I think there's some implications that they're making, and again, depends on what you want to do with the policy. If you're saying this is, if you're defining it from a diagnostic condition, then it has to meet that criteria. But if you're just making a general, this is what it is, and I think that goes to the core of the question that we need to ask is what is the role of the dentist? Is it to diagnose it? Is it to treat sleep apnea? So I think that would probably depend on what you would want to put there, I guess.
Gotcha. So maybe we need to jump to the rest of the rule, perhaps, which provides the regulatory framework, and maybe that will help that discussion as we fine-tune that. Part of the rule will help then ultimately with the definition, perhaps. But we've got two more comments here on the webinar. We have a Patrick Prendergast, a dentist, who says defining OSA as an upper airway collapse ignores the velopharynx and the collapse of the tongue base against the airway. OSA is an event. The disease is commonly referred to as obstructive sleep apnea disorder and must meet specific diagnostic criteria with regards to length and desaturation as well as sleep arousal. So that was from Joe Tile or Till. And then Patrick Prendergast had another comment. I believe MDs consider the nose and the oral pharynx and the upper airway and the base of the tongue and velopharynx as lower airway. And as a layperson, none of that makes any sense to me, so I will turn it off to the professionals in the room in the webinar to provide commentary in response to those comments.
Mo, I can address the definition a little bit.
Thank you, Dave.
Here's an alternative we can consider, and I'll just read it out loud. I'll email it to you. Obstructive sleep apnea is a sleep disorder that involves cessation or significant decrease in airflow in the presence of breathing effort. It is the most common type of sleep disordered breathing and is characterized by recurrent episodes of upper airway collapse during sleep. These episodes are associated with recurrent oxyhemoglobin desaturations and arousals from sleep.
Sounds good to me.
I like that.
I think we want to keep it general. We don't want to get into the fine details of apneas for 10 seconds and 4% desaturations. That's a diagnostic criteria versus a general definition.
Can you email it to me, Dave?
What's that?
Can you email me that definition you just read?
I did.
Okay, great. Perfect. Thanks.
That's from the original group that defined the syndrome back in 1976.
Patrick, would you like to speak? Patrick Prendergast? You're unmuted on this end. Or feel free just to write in your comment again if you'd like. Adam, we saw that you sent us a link to something. Oh, Patrick, thank you for clarifying. You don't have an oral comment. Please remove the hand raise signal if you could at your convenience. All right, should we move down to the rest of the rule here, the main rule, I should say. So rule one was just a definition to include with our definition section of the rules. And then rule 26 is potentially the home of an obstructive sleep apnea rule, where we then start to provide some requirements. And once again, this is all cobbled together from a variety of sources. So I don't remember exactly where everything came from, other than as a starting point, the education piece, which is in section C, was borrowed from the Texas rule. It was the only dental rule I could find that had some specifics with regard to education. But once again, this is just all a starting point to elicit some discussion. Yes, Sue?
From a legal perspective, on Part A, where you have a dentist shall not independently diagnose and or treat OSA without coordination and collaboration with a physician. Okay. I have a problem, a little bit of a problem with independently diagnose, because you're saying what it could be read to say would be is if you have coordination and collaboration with physician, you can independently diagnose. And it was my understanding, and I'm not arguing one way or the other, but it was my understanding that most of the resources we had felt that dentists could not diagnose this condition. You see what I'm saying? It's a twisted way of looking at it, but I understand that in coordination and collaboration, they can treat, because that seems to flow from the diagnosis made by the physician. But I'm a little worried that someone might argue that under this, as long as they're working with the doctor and they have a doctor's name written down in their file and that kind of thing, they can go ahead and diagnose it.
So is your thought that you would prefer that the word independently be removed? Would that make it?
Whether a dentist can diagnose, and if they can't, then I don't think we can write it like this. That's all.
I think that's a good point, Sue. I would recommend moving independently to be right in front of treat and remove it from in front of diagnose.
My name is Andrew Bancroft. So Medicare has established guidelines that are almost written in crayon, and they address this directly, and the Medicare rules are pretty much written as such. So it says that no aspect of a home sleep test, including but not limited to the delivery and or pickup of the device, may be performed by a DME supplier. The DME supplier in this case is the dentist, as it applies to obstructive sleep apnea. So basically saying that the testing appliance or device cannot even pass through the dentist's office.
Well, I think that's a different issue than what we're talking about right at this moment, but I'm certainly happy to hear more about that. I was just worried about the issue of diagnosis and if we're sticking within the Dental Practice Act or not, you know, by dealing with that.
So as Dave suggested, we moved the word, a dentist shall not diagnose and or independently treat obstructive sleep apnea. Does that help? Okay. Laura Jacob, you are on. Can you put up the screen and we can see the written comments too? Perhaps you just... Laura, did you want to have a verbal comment or did you accidentally raise your hand?
Mo, can you hear me?
Oh, yes. There you are.
I did not have a comment. Sorry, I thought I raised my hand when you wanted to know if I could hear you, and then I thought I put it back in. So,
thanks for
read me down, right?
It's great to hear from you, though. Sorry to
yep.
not like that.
Yep, enjoying listening. Thank you.
Thank you. Adam Wirtz, did you have a verbal comment?
Yes, but it was in regards to A1, if we're there yet.
We're still on A, it sounds like, but we'll hold your thought for A1.
Sounds good.
And then there's a written comment. Oh, Dr. Hickey has a written comment. You will need to, I think he was trying to say, specifically define the terms coordination and collaboration. Dr. Hickey feels those need to be defined.
I heard a couple of people in the room say no. Do we need to define those terms?
I would ask him why he thinks that.
I would ask Dr. Hickey why he thinks they need to be defined. They have common dictionary meanings, and it could add a lot of restriction where restriction isn't necessary if they got defined in a particular way.
And that's coming from an attorney. Yeah, Dr. Hickey, hold on 1 second. We've got someone in the room that wants to speak.
Sorry, Doc. So my concern with that is that there's models in town that presently all this is insurance driven. The insurance companies have their own regulation utilization review. There are models in town that are specifically cash based. So I can give you, for example, the dentist screens. The dentist owns a sleep testing device, does his own testing. He uploads it. It's a watermark device. He doesn't have to get a medical doctor to read it. He can just have it scored by a technician. He orders the appliance. There's nothing expressly prohibiting a dentist from ordering the appliance. So he screens the patient all the way through testing, cash pay, no medical doctor involved, period. It's all over town.
Violation of this rule.
Well, so it needs to be a little more clear.
Well, the rule clearly says it's in collaboration with the physician. So I think that takes care of that. Dr. Hickey?
Yeah, sorry, guys. I picked up the flu on the way back from Chicago. So hope you can hear me okay. So yeah, coordination and collaboration can mean anything. I mean, it could be something that I think it needs to be more specific. Like, does the dentist actually have a prescription for the oral appliance? When a patient comes to the dentist on CPAP and they want an oral appliance, that dentist is now discontinuing a medical therapy. They're basically displacing the patient's prescribed CPAP with an oral appliance. And the way this is written would not prevent them from doing that. And in my view, that violates the Medical Practice Act.
So Dr. Hickey, the rest of the rule goes into more specifics. So potentially that answers your question. I'll take a look at paragraph B.
Right.
And everything underneath it.
The other thing to keep in mind is the treatment of obstructive sleep apnea isn't just giving an oral appliance or CPAP. It can include sleep agents like Ambien and Lunesta. It can include wakefulness promoting agents like Provigil and Nuvigil. So when you're talking about treating obstructive sleep apnea, you have to talk about treating the neurological consequences of disrupted sleep, et cetera. So a dentist can't treat sleep apnea under any circumstances. What they can do and what they're experts at doing, and they should be the only ones doing this, and this rule should protect them, is they can provide an oral appliance. They can provide custom-made durable medical equipment. But I think when you start getting into this treating obstructive sleep apnea, which is a medical condition, it's not a oral cavity problem. It's a medical condition. It's not a problem of the teeth and gums. That really needs to be looked at because that's going to open up a can of worms.
Okay. So now it sounds like we're switching the concern from coordination, collaboration to the part that needs independently treat. Is that accurate?
Yeah. I mean, I think they both have issues. Coordination and collaboration are really, really nebulous terms. And it just leaves, I mean, is having a business relationship with a physician in some way coordination and collaboration? Is sharing notes? So if you just send over your office visit notes without actually, you know, that could be interpreted as pretty much anything.
Mm-hmm. But one could interpret something more to be too prescriptive as well. So I think the idea is to make sure that there is a relationship between the dentist and the ultimately treating physician.
Right.
He or she develops that with each other is up to professionals, is how this starting document is laying it out without being too prescriptive.
Right, but the problem is if you leave it up to them to do that, then there's no need for a rule, because that's the whole reason we're here right now, is we've got problems with the way it's being done.
So Dr. Hickey, would you propose that we strike the language in A that starts after rule one dash or one paragraph run without the coordination collaboration.
You repeat that, Dave?
Treat obstructive sleep apnea. Period. So they can't diagnose it. I think we're all clear on that, and they're not treating it. Giving someone, this is the sticking point. Giving someone an oral appliance is not treating sleep apnea any more than a durable medical commitment provider giving someone CPAP is treating sleep apnea. There, you wouldn't say that a durable medical equipment provider is treating sleep apnea. It's the physician who is managing that patient and ultimately responsible for the clinical outcomes.
Yeah, it's somewhat semantic. They are providing treatment.
They're providing a custom medical equipment. Right. I mean, are you going to say that?
Well, they're treating the patient. They're diagnosing TMJ, their occlusion. They're not just handing them a device and sending them home. They're actually providing treatment.
Right, but all of those things that you just mentioned are dental consequences of the oral appliance, which they should be managing, which is perfectly fine. That is their domain. But the treatment of obstructive sleep apnea, so that you're basically saying it's okay for them to prescribe wakefulness promoting agents, sleep hypnotic, because that is part of treating. Well, that's what it says here. I mean, they're able to treat obstructive sleep apnea. Any physician
says they're not allowed to independently treat obstructive sleep apnea.
Right. But so what this is saying, though, if they have coordination with the physician, then they could potentially do those things, right? They can do whatever it takes to treat sleep apnea.
So that's my question. Would you be okay with A if we took out everything after rule one, paragraph one?
Hey, Dave, before we get into specifics about that, I think some of the members here wanted to clarify a couple of things. I think there's some misunderstanding about what the rest of the rule says.
So one of my thoughts to help clarify the concerns was to break up, because we really talk about the dentist's role in treatment under B, and what if we just removed that part? The dentist cannot diagnose sleep apnea, here are the things that the dentist can do, something like that, and then put the part about treatment down in B, which then pertains specifically to the oral appliance and not the remainder of treatment of obstructive sleep apnea. I think we've agreed upon that.
Right. I think that makes sense. I mean, because now you're getting specific. You're saying specifically what a dentist can do within their scope of practice as it pertains to the treatment of sleep apnea. So they can provide a custom fabricated, you know, oral appliance as it says there. So perhaps that's what you do. A dentist shall not diagnose obstructive sleep apnea, period. I think we all agree that a dentist should not be diagnosing obstructive sleep apnea, right?
What I'm wondering is, Dr. Hickey, maybe,
don't forget to introduce yourself.
My name is Lori Schmidt, and you would probably have to take that up with AASM, who wrote the practice parameters. But a dentist who makes a DME for the treatment, or we are treating, we're not just sticking a piece of acrylic in a patient's mouth. It has to be put at a specific position to open up the airway to not allow obstruction during sleep. That is treating the problem. It is opening the airway and not allowing this patient to obstruct and die during sleep. If a patient comes with a CPAP to an office and says, I will not wear this, then you need to get a prescription from the ordering physician. But a patient going without anything is just can't happen. And putting an appliance in a patient's mouth willy-nilly and really the meaning, what that is crazy. You need to put it in an appropriate position. So I do believe these appliances do treat sleep apnea. Thank you.
That's not what I was saying. So if we stick with the analogy of someone setting someone up on CPAP, a durable medical equipment provider, they lay the patient down generally, they decide which mask they're going to use, and then they adjust the pressures on the machine just like a dentist in an analogous fashion would adjust that oral appliance. Adjusting an oral appliance doesn't all of a sudden make you the treating physician of obstructive sleep apnea, which, as I've said multiple times, is not merely opening the airway. It's dealing with all the neurological sequelae that come with that disorder.
Okay.
So,
Dr. Baldwin?
No, can you?
Hold on, Dave. I think Dr. Baldwin had something to say.
No, Dave can speak.
Okay. Dave, go ahead.
I just don't like the direction that the conversation's heading. We're not robots as dentists. We're not there like a vending machine to hand out a piece of plastic for a mandibular advancement device.
I was actually thinking more of a mechanic, what I was hearing. But yeah, great.
I would be in favor of leaving independently treat sleep apnea in A. I still think dentists that provide oral appliance therapy are treating the patient.
Co-treating the patient.
They're on the hook with the board if they were to somehow perform malpractice. So they're not treating, they're not holistically or globally treating obstructive sleep apnea, but they are providing a treatment for sleep apnea.
Right. Dr. Baldwin, you had a comment?
Yeah, I mean, I think that my suggestion would be to not start with the point in A, but start with actually the number one. So start that section as number one. This A would be a dentist shall screen for sleep apnea utilizing tools. So, I mean, I think starting it in the manner in which you think about, you know, approaching.
Oh, sorry, Dr. Baldwin, you're going to have to repeat the second half of what you were saying. We lost you there.
Oh, sorry. I'm not sure why it's cutting out. It's asking me to go to audio, and I guess maybe I should do that. I don't know if you guys can answer me that. I guess my thought process when you're writing the rule is to start as if you're approaching the patient with a potential disease process. So my suggestion would be, instead of starting A with that particular sentence, mm-hmm. starting it with the screening process. Right? Because I think we all agree that dentists see patients. They have the opportunity to recognize that a patient might potentially have sleep apnea. Therefore, it would make sense to me to kind of start with that.
Okay.
And kind of as a stepping point, say, you know, I think we can, again, I think we can all agree that dentists have the opportunity to screen patients, and so by what manner is it appropriate for them to be screening? I think we're just jumping down to the whole diagnosing and treatment without kind of going in that order. Anyway, I think I've made my point clear.
I believe a dentist should screen 100% of the patients coming through their office without question, because they're looking in the mouth, they're looking at the airway. The problem becomes when they start screening again, when they're outside of the loop of the insurance regulations. When the insurance companies aren't able to regulate them, what Lori said earlier about one state prohibiting dentists from ordering the study, that's patently false. Colorado currently is regulated by the number of medical insurance companies. Cigna doesn't even allow a dentist to order a sleep study. Medicare requires a face-to-face visit. Insurance companies are presently credentialing, air quotes, dentists, requiring them to become out-of-network recognized providers for DME. A dentist in every insurance company, Medicare included, across the board is recognized as a DME. I got an email today from Cigna saying, we have requested CareCentric to review all Cigna claims paid to Colorado dentists throughout 2015 and 2016 and for CPT E0486. If it is determined that the MAS, mandibular advancement discipline, I guess in their words, or the diagnostic sleep test was not ordered by a medical physician, we will begin the process of an escalated review to determine if there are or should be a request for refund by the member or the provider. Additionally, if the diagnostic test was performed or if the DME is deemed to be in any way a participant, Cigna will begin the process of escalated review to determine if there should be a request for refund by the member or the provider. So this is insurance-driven. The insurance companies do have their own utilization review, which prohibits these processes. But when we have organizations out there in the community, they're doing things on a cash basis. I called one of them last week and spoke specifically to the girl up front. She said, you can get an order from Dr. So-and-so. You just come into our dental office and the sleep physician will sign an order for the test. And if it comes back positive, he'll sign an order for treatment. So two things can be problematic there is that sleep physician never sees the patient and writes the order for the device, or he just writes a recommendation which does not meet the qualification of an order, but a dentist proceeds with treatment, and now he's practicing outside of his scope.
So just by me, this is Donna Baldwin with the medical board, and Dr. Higgy, I really appreciate your comments, but I think by means of kind of order, I think what would be really helpful for me, and again, it's my own fault for not being able to attend the meeting in person today, but I think this should be the committee members kind of talking, and I think if you have a comment, I think that it would be best for us to kind of either ask questions or, I don't know, Mo, I'm just having trouble, again, because I'm remote. And Dave, I don't know if you're there or you're remote, if you're having the same trouble. But I just think as a committee, it sounds like we probably need to be driving a lot of the conversation and then asking for input or if people have notes. I'm just having a lot of trouble.
Yeah, no, absolutely, Dr. Baldwin, you're correct. This is your meeting. We had the stakeholder input part of it. If you would like us to shut down additional stakeholder input for now and let you guys just chat, that's absolutely an option for you guys to do. Just let us know how you would like to proceed. And then with that being said, too, you have to remember the dental board's role versus the physician, the medical board.
Correct. I'm just here at your mercy.
Yeah, this is not for you. This is actually for everybody in the room and on the webinar, right? The dental board cannot say what type of physician should be involved in this. It can't say whether the physician has to directly see the patient or not. The dental board has no role in any of that, right? The board can say you, the dentist, have to do it through a physician, but how the physician decides to do it is up to the physician and the medical board. So I hope that point is made clear as well. And with regards to insurance and all that, we're not slaves, for lack of a better word, to insurance. There's obviously the insurance companies will do what the insurance companies want to do. We here are in place to clarify what the legislator has said is allowable in Colorado, right? And then the board can then clarify what that means in order to practice safely and effectively for patient care in Colorado. How the insurance companies react to that is up to the insurance company. And if a dentist wants to charge you cash and not go to an insurance company, do something that's legal, and then that's up to him or her as well. We're not here to set the marketplace. We're here to make sure we're allowing for individuals to practice as they see fit within the framework of statute and rules. So I hope that clarification helps as well. But Dr. Baldwin and Dr. Thurgood, you're the only two committee members on the webinar. The other two committee members are in the room, and they seem interested in just having the discussion with you guys at this point as well. So that being said, sorry, and keep repeating that, I apologize. Dr. Butler has made some tweaks to A. So Dr. Ball, I don't know if you've had a chance to see that, or Dr. Thurgood, it should be up on your screens. Take a look at that and see if you have any comments about that. She took out quite a bit of the introduction language that I had in there before. And she just made it clear she's not married to it either. And Sue, I think, wants to say something.
Dr. Baldwin, I just wanted to say, if you think that we should put the rule in order of how treatment would actually go, that's fine. But the rule that I have says a dentist shall screen for sleep apnea. We've never had that discussion yet about whether we were going to mandate sleep apnea be tested by all dentists. That's a whole different discussion that I have not heard yet, and I've been here the whole time. So it's one thing to just move the position where you put screening ahead of diagnosis. That's fine. I mean, I don't care what order it goes in, but, you know. And then
I completely agree with you. I mean, I've been writing notes this whole time, and I feel like there's things that we probably as a committee haven't discussed. What is the role of the dentist, and what is the role in the dentist with screening? What is the role of the dentist in treatment? What is the role of the dentist with the role of the physician? And I think those are kind of some basic things that maybe we haven't discussed, or is that kind of what you're saying, or?
Can I just add a couple things?
Go, I think it's just the four of us now talking, Dave, so just go.
Fire away. Yeah, having gone through a similar process with the anesthesia rules, my recommendation would be to start with what you feel is most important and put that at the top. My experience is most of the licensees do very little reading of the rules. And so if your main point is to let them know what they shouldn't be doing, then I would put that first, followed by what they are allowed to do.
I agree with Dave. I think that's why I like it with the diagnosis part first, because that's what everybody's looking at, and that's really what the subsections are about, is the diagnosis of it. And then we're saying, yes, they're allowed to screen. I like may better than shall, simply because while it would be great for everybody to do it, unless we're going to start disciplining because they don't have a documented sleep apnea screen in the dental chart the way we would for periodontal charting and things like that, it's a problem, I think, for us to get in the business of saying shall.
No,
I agree. I like may instead of shall for the screening. I still like A, the way it was before, where it said a dentist shall not diagnose obstructive, or a dentist shall not diagnose or independently treat obstructive sleep apnea.
I agree with Dave. I do think I liked how you guys. I agree with you. I think that being upfront about the main issue. I think I see your point. I think that sounds good. You had it up there, a dentist shall not diagnose or independently treat obstructive sleep apnea. Is that a good enough sentence? And then finish with what you have. Is that what you were thinking, Dave?
Yeah, and then just take out the in collaboration or communication with a physician. Because I think that's kind of nebulous. Also, Dave. I do have a concern with the way the rest of the rule reads, where
okay, see you later.
It talks about being able to fabricate a device unless it's prescribed by a physician. I can see the loophole there would be these sleep medicine dentists that just get a family physician to write the prescription for it, then they've satisfied our rule. It doesn't really meet the spirit of the law.
Right, and I think that probably what was said involved the concern with, you know, a patient comes to you as a dentist saying they want an appliance because they're not going to do their CPAP, and the dentist just independently says, okay, well, I'll just, you know, manage you with this, with the appliance, versus notifying the physician, hey, your patient doesn't want to do CPAP, I'm going to do this, and what's the follow-up?
The only other question I had is, you know, part of potentially separating up treatment part in A is that the rest of A deals with diagnosis. I almost wonder if we should have a, like, Roman numeral one above that or something that has sort of the big statement and then separate diagnosis, treatment, something. Because I think that's where Dr. Hickey was getting maybe tied up, is that the treatment part was not addressed till later. Because one and two under A specifically talk about diagnosis and screening and not treatment.
Yeah, and as you pointed out earlier, the only reason I started off with that is it seemed like most of the discussion we've heard was around those points. Mm-hmm. If there's a better way to lay it out and introduce it and then transition into that, start firing away. No, unfortunately, the committee members made it clear.
So I think, Dave, did you want the, so I'm looking at that second sentence. Did you want to, I think we wanted to stop it after rule one. Is that right?
I would take out without coordination and collaboration with a physician.
Well, you can take it out of there, Dave, but you're going to have to put it in somewhere. It has to be made clear that they have to be working with a physician. At least that's how I understood it.
I think B addresses that.
So maybe beef up B when we get there. Okay, let me cut it out. But you wanted the old introduction language, a dentist shall not diagnose and or independently treat obstructive sleep apnea. Is that correct?
Yeah.
I like that.
Okay. Dr. Bolt?
I think I like it. Yep. And were you guys thinking not to put some introduction in there?
No.
No, meaning you weren't going to do any introduction, or you were?
There's a definition of OSA above that. I just don't think you can see it on the screen.
Oh, okay. Right. All right. Sorry. Okay.
You can leave it as defined OSA pursuant goes into to rule 1.1.
This is going
right.
to be like 60 pages later.
Yeah, so the definition of OSA, which they've emailed me one that you guys like better, will go into rule one, paragraph I, and then when we go into the actual obstructive sleep apnea rule itself, when it mentions sleep apnea for the first time, it then defers to the definition in rule one I.
So I think we're okay then. And I like two also.
So are people okay with A, one, and two?
Do you guys think that we need to do more definition when we say consultation with the patient's physician? Are you feeling like we have to have more definition to that so that it doesn't happen like this one gentleman testified when he said they just get some doctor to sign a form and sign off on it without ever meeting the patient and all that kind of stuff he said is going on? Do you think we need to put anything in here about the kind of physician, like patient sleep physician, or not?
I had thought about this, and I thought the medical board should be the one that would make that decision. What type of physician would have to be involved? If they want to go to that kind of level versus the dental board saying what type of physician has to be, because all the dental board has control is over the dentist.
True, but you would be saying the dentist has to confer with a sleep physician. That's not telling the doctors what to do. That's saying the dentist has to use this physician.
But at the same time, there's not that many boarded sleep physicians in rural areas. I mean, there's plenty of family physicians who may order sleep tests in areas where access to specialty care is limited. I do think that prescribing, that's more the medical board's jurisdiction as to how they want the physicians to be ordering it. Right. The only thought is, you know, collaboration is, or consultation is sort of a loose term. I mean, under a lot of things, the physician has to order it as opposed to just sort of, well, I ran it by some guy, right? I mean, I don't know if anybody else has thoughts about that.
Where does that work?
All right, only after consultation, as opposed to only after.
I think the concern is that there's a sleep study that's ordered, and how is it interpreted? Because I think that using the sleep study as a diagnostic test, I think there's multiple things that have to go into the diagnosis. And so I think, again, now you're getting to the diagnostic part of it. So you've already said that the dentist is not going to diagnose it. So it's going to be diagnosed by someone else.
Well, the question is, should we replace the word consultation with a different word or a bunch of words?
I mean, I think you've already solved it, right? Because you're saying that up top on A that you're not diagnosing it. And so if the dentist is not diagnosing it, they shouldn't be using those tools to diagnose it either, right? So the diagnosis, maybe that's the statement that needs to be made, that the diagnosis of sleep apnea has to be made by the physician and not a diagnostic, not a tool.
I mean, that's
or a monitor. I mean, I think that's what the concern was, right?
So what I just changed it to was only after ordered by the patient's physician, instead of saying only after a consultation with the patient's physician.
I mean, it doesn't really matter to me who orders what diagnostic tool. It's who's using the tools to make the diagnosis, right?
Well, we have, yeah, but they're not allowed to order the tools, or at least that's the way we've written it so far.
Yeah, and then some people have argued once you order the tool, you basically own it. You own the
right.
Yeah.
I mean, I have patients that come to me all the time, right, with here are lab results that were ordered by X naturopath or X, you know, lab technician, and then I'm responsible for making a diagnosis off of those tools. It's not my favorite part of my job, right, because I would like to be able to order the test to make the diagnosis after I get the history from the patient and all that.
Well, the next sentence
That's a good point, actually.
The dentist cannot independently determine which testing devices are most appropriate, prescribe such devices for testing the patient, interpret the results, and develop a course of treatment. So that pretty much says it all right there, what the dentist cannot do.
Says the physician can order it and the dentist can dispense it, but the dentist cannot interpret and therefore treat based upon those results.
And I like that section. I think that's very
clear. I just wonder if you want to be more specific that and make a statement of the diagnosis of obstructive sleep apnea needs to be made by a physician. Because I could read this and say, well, I'm not interpreting it. I'm not, you know what I mean? That the machine is interpreting it. Because isn't that part of what kind of the problem is right now, is that they're using it as a diagnostic tool and not considering the patient's history per se or the intricacies of what particular tool that they're using, right? Because obstructive sleep apnea is more than just the sleep study itself.
So would you want to put that sentence up front in number two, only a physician may diagnose OSA?
Here, I got something.
I don't know, Dave. What do you think?
I like two. I think we need to keep it in some form there.
I do too.
I would not be opposed to adding a line to A that spells out that the diagnosis and treatment of obstructive sleep apnea is under the purview of a physician.
I just tweet the first sentence in two. Take a look at it. Oh, sorry. It reads now HST or HSAT devices in polysomnography and are diagnostic tools that may be dispensed by a dentist but may only be ordered and interpreted by the patient's physician.
The only thing I would say is you want to be careful about writing a rule that then you're going to have to edit later because of new technology.
Well, you know.
So do you want to just be more, do you want to just add into A what Dave just said? And then it kind of qualifies everything. You can put.
So they want the sentence in A. Okay. That a physician must make the diagnosis.
I think we say obstructive sleep apnea is a medical condition that must be diagnosed by, or we could say something like obstructive sleep apnea is a medical condition that must be diagnosed by a medical provider.
No, physician.
I know, but then there's independent nurse practitioners, there's PAs who are working under a physician. It's
well, I don't know if they can diagnose it or not. You know, so that's not.
She would have to countersign on it, I would imagine.
I mean, for PAs, yes, but a lot of nurse practitioners are independent.
But what if you said something to the effect that you just refer back to the Medical Practice Act?
It's really not our purview. As long as we just say a medical provider, it's not a dentist, right? So.
Right. I mean, I agree with what you're
saying. The board needs
saying you don't want to necessarily limit it to a physician.
Well, but if they don't see that. You could have a lab tech diagnose it, and they could defend if you put medical provider. It could be anything. I don't think so. I don't think so.
Do you want to list them all out?
Well, no, I don't. I didn't want the sentence, but.
I think we need to stick with physician.
I do too.
We'll start it there.
I don't think PAs and nurse practitioners have no business doing sleep medicine.
They may, yeah. I mean, we'll find out. At the end of the day, it's, you know, this is starting off with the Colorado Dental Board and the Colorado Medical Board, but we'll be sharing this with all healthcare programs, and who knows who else will come out of the woodwork.
I do think there are probably great qualified physician assistants in that do practice great sleep medicine.
I mean, there was somebody here from National Jewish who was a PA speaking last time we were here.
Are they practicing independent of a physician?
No.
Not in Colorado, but nurse practitioners can practice independent of a physician in the state. And I know that a lot of the medical providers in the Department of Corrections are nurse practitioners. And a lot in rural areas, I mean, there's psychiatric nurse, and again, I'm not a sleep doctor, but there's a lot of psychiatric nurse practitioners who do almost the same thing as me. There's a few, legal things they can't do related to involuntarily treating people, but otherwise, so I don't know. I don't think the dental board needs to be in the position of saying who can or can't, other than it's not a dentist, and it has to be.
Well, I don't know. We just heard 2 hours of presentations about how complex sleep apnea is and how much morbidity and mortality is associated with it. Now we're going to just let nurses and PAs treat it?
Over that anyway. I was just saying by a licensed medical provider and
that's not going to work unless you have a definition of licensed medical provider. If you just can't say that, the dentist then will feel like he can get anybody who's a licensed medical provider. It's not going to meet the conditions that everybody's been talking about.
I believe there's probably some language in the Medical Practice Act as well as in the Nursing Practice Act for nurse practitioners around, I mean, what you're saying is that it's a medical condition. And so there's got to be some language around who diagnoses a medical condition. I don't know if I have my.
I mean, when you read the guidelines for treating obstructive sleep apnea by the AASM and AD or AADSM, they both recommend oral appliance therapy as prescribed by a sleep physician. They don't go in, they don't mention anything about a nurse practitioner or a PA.
What if we just started off, and just simply said, OSA is a medical condition, and that a dentist shall not diagnose and or independently treat it as defined in Rule 1I. Unless she is also licensed as a physician, and just leave it at that.
I like that.
The problem is you're trying to make it clear to Dennis what and who can do it. And so we're not trying to say who can do it here, but we are trying to make it clear to our licensees who they can have as a supervising person. Now, I don't have any problem with what you said, Mo, that's fine, but I'm just saying that our job is to make it clear to dentists what they can do and who they can rely on if they're going to do it with somebody else.
Like in corrections, which is my area, the vast, I think there's like 3 licensed, there's 3 medical physicians, right? And there's plenty of dentists who practice in DOC, and they have a whole protocol where the medical provider, who's a nurse practitioner, listens and the patient is sent for a sleep study and all of these things. And so, I mean, you know, are we then regulating those dentists that they can't do it based on the medical provider, right? I mean, it just, it gets ugly for certain systems, I think. clear. I mean, I think the diagnosis was made appropriately. They do get referred. They have a whole protocol for how they do it, but ultimately, it would go back to the treatment provider at that person's facility, which is probably enough, even though it's really appropriate.
Corrections isn't the large percentage, though, of what's going on.
No, but I'm
not hearing any of the discussion right now.
Sorry.
She's saying she's not hearing.
Yeah, she's not hearing you.
Okay, so you want me to say it again?
Yes, please.
Okay. I was just saying, so I work in corrections, and so, I mean, it's a huge integrated system, of course, but the vast majority of the medical providers are nurse practitioners who then, you know, there's a protocol, and the patients do end up getting referred for a sleep study, which is interpreted, but then sent back for treatment at the facility, and so it may be that the actual ordering provider is a mid-level, even though it went through the appropriate sleep testing. And it just, I mean, I know that's a very narrow circumstance, but there are probably other systems in which it's some kind of framework like that. And I just don't know that the dental board needs to specify who, as long as it was appropriately done. Is that?
And I agree with you.
And I don't.
I don't either. I think you have to spell it out for these guys.
Well, shall we just go on and come back to it?
Yeah, I mean,
ultimately, it's up to you guys.
Ultimately, if they're getting polysomnography, they're going to be evaluated and diagnosed by a board-certified sleep medicine physician. I just don't, I'm unaware of any board-certified sleep medicine nurse practitioners or PAs, and I could be wrong.
I think there was one. I think I think we heard from one.
There was definitely a PA in the room at the last meeting. I just don't remember the...
Board-certified? Do they have a board for certification for that?
PAs don't, generally.
Right. I mean, the fact that we don't know, I think, basically... provides credence to what Dr. Butler is saying, that maybe we don't want to be too prescriptive here because we might be leaving somebody out unintentionally and causing an unintended consequence. But at the same time, I do hear what Dave is saying. A lot of people, if you don't...
So the mad scramble is going to be to hire a PA or a nurse, better yet, a nurse practitioner who can practice independently to come to your sleep clinic and prescribe all of your devices. I'm not comfortable with that at all.
I think the bottom line, though, is that, I mean, I agree with you, Dave, and I totally see where you're coming from. I think that this is tough.
Well, I mean, here's my point. Dentists we're licensed medical providers, and if we're going to take away their ability to send somebody home with a sleep test but then allow nurse practitioners and PAs to do it, I think that's absurd.
Well, a PA does underneath the supervision of a physician, is my understanding. So there's that connection. The independent nurse practitioner obviously can do some things independent of a physician. I just don't know what extent.
Okay, so we want to have nurses treating obstructive sleep apnea, but not dentists. I don't get that.
Hey.
But I mean, that's up to the
I have... 4 years of dental school, 4 years of a hospital-based surgical residency, and I wouldn't be able to practice at a higher level than a nurse practitioner. I think that's silly.
I think the point is that is the practice specific thing. So, you know, a PA and a nurse practitioner are taking care of the whole person, and so they're making that particular medical diagnosis. And really, I think when we get down to the more specifics, it's their responsibility to help with the follow-up, right? To make sure that what follow-up test is being taken. Are they well managed on the the appliance, or do they need a sleep study to really encourage sleep apnea, or do they need something else? I mean, the onus is then on that medical provider to.
So somebody with a four-year degree in some clinical rotations in nursing and a couple of extra training sessions for nurse practitioner school, they're more qualified than a board certified sleep dental medicine person.
I have my own opinions that are not probably something I would be sharing in this forum, but I think that I hear what you're saying, and I think that at this time legally that's their scope of practice.
Yeah, so we have to remember here, it's what is the scope of practice as allowed in Colorado by statute? So, I mean, I have no idea how far the nursing statute allows certain types of nurses to carry out aspects of medicine. But we have no control over that on this end of things. We'll definitely be communicating with them and saying, does this somehow negatively impact what you're allowed to do here in Colorado? But we do have to be careful and recognize that there may be potential impact on other professions. Whether you agree that they'd be allowed to do it or not is a different issue. If they're allowed to do it in Colorado, they're allowed to do it in Colorado. All we have is jurisdiction over clarifying what a dentist can do in Colorado, given the statutory construct of a scope of practice for a dentist in Colorado, if that makes sense.
If our role is to provide protection for patients, why are we not allowed to tell the dentists who they can send their patient to in the interest of patient safety?
Well, you can, but at the same time, you're also, in a way, defining what is allowed by another profession, right? So that's where you need to be careful about not going too far. I understand the argument. We'll always be considering the background, right? Patient safety, for sure. Also, potentially unnecessary restriction of access to care, right? Those are always two things you're going to always be dealing with. But you have to do it in a framework where you have control and are allowed to have that control, right? You can't dictate what another profession has jurisdiction over. So the medical board will have to decide, as we mentioned earlier, what the physician's role in all of this is, what type of qualifications he or she has to have, and what type of patient, direct access to the patient that they need to have, all that stuff. So if you say it has to be with a board-certified physician who has to see the patient, you're basically dictating what the medical board should be dictating.
Well, then why don't we let the medical board write the whole rule then? They can just say you can't, if you're treating sleep apnea, you're practicing outside the scope of dentistry, practicing medicine, and we'd be done.
I don't think it's that black and white. I think we've had testimony in front of us about how some dentists are running the office and doing sleep apnea in a way that I think most of us would not consider to be really safe for the patient. The physician isn't seeing the patient. They're having somebody sign orders, that kind of thing. That's my concern here. My concern isn't what the scope of practice for nurse practitioners is. My concern is that dentists know what they can and can't do. And one of the things they shouldn't be able to do is to have some provider, be it a PA or a doctor, just signing forms and giving them blank forms so they can ram somebody through on a test, and then the doctor signs off on it without ever, having any interaction. That's what I'm worried about. It's not defining the scope of practice for those other areas.
I agree completely, but my point is if our concern is patient safety and we don't feel like a nurse practitioner or a PA is an appropriate person to be providing guidance to dentists, then let's just put it in our rule that it needs to be a physician. And I haven't heard anybody from the nursing side of things or the PAs accusing us of limiting their scope of practice.
I think in the interest of time, I think let's leave it like it is, and then, you know, I'm sure Mo will get some feedback, and we can, you know, I think let's move on and see if we can get some more work done, or it's 6 o'clock, do we want to stop?
Yeah, and also, it basically indirectly says that in the end of A and the end of B, when it says unless he or she is also licensed as a physician, it doesn't say licensed as a physician or as a practitioner, you know, the running list. So I guess there's an indirect reference to it, but we will definitely be running this by other folks. And by no means is this going to be the final product. It probably won't be anywhere close to being the final product when you guys get done with it. We just see what the medical board does. Of course, it'll be interesting to see what we hear from other folks who want to weigh in on this as well.
Well, why don't we just table it until the medical board meets then? This whole thing was brought up by physicians.
Correct.
If they're so concerned about it, then the medical board can get on their horse, draft a rule, and then we can follow.
Well, we don't want to – it was brought to you, Dave. So the onus okay. has been brought –
I'll make a motion to table until the medical board addresses it.
I think the idea is you take a crack at it, and the medical board will also take a crack at it. And then hopefully doing that through that process – both boards will come up with something that will work for their licensed population. They'll take a crack at it. They'll also look at it and may come up with their own thing. Or who knows? Maybe both boards will look at it after further discussion and say, you know what, maybe the rule is not the way to go. Maybe it should be a joint policy. I don't know.
But instead of, it sounds to me like they just dumped the burden on us. Now we got to wade through this thing, whether nurse practitioners should be able to do it, PA should be able to do it. Let's let them take track at that.
If the medical board is not dumping anything on you, this was brought to you, the dental board, by interested stakeholders.
Okay.
Dave, I'm here.
I'm just saying, if we're going to wait and see what they're going to do, then let's let them start working on it. We'll table it until they've come up with a framework, and then we'll work in conjunction with them.
Well, they have a committee member on your committee, so they basically have started the process as well. You're just ahead of them, and I think it's okay to be ahead.
Okay. Well, I'll make a motion to table until they catch up.
Oh, we're not entertaining
them. We'll see you.
Let's just get through this document to a good working place, and we will definitely kick it over to the medical board and get their feedback on it. I think it's important that the dental board has some say in it and start this because it was brought to the dental board.
I agree completely. That's what I'm saying. They can tell us who the appropriate person is to order, diagnose, and treat sleep apnea and save us all the back and forth whether nurses and PAs can do it.
So maybe we just leave that sentence as it is. And let's see if we can get any work. Do we want to continue, Mo? Do we want to?
Yeah, I think we should continue. I mean, we've come this far. I mean, we didn't gain hours and hours of stakeholder input. We have to do something.
So let's move down then to number two. There's two. Looks like there's two suggestions for number two. Is that right?
Yeah, well, yeah, one was the first one was slightly modified based on some discussion, but then we went up and modified A. And so the one below it is the original language that was in two. So top two is modified slightly. The bottom two is what was originally proposed. Is there one preference for one of the two, a combination of the two?
I like the original.
I like the new two.
Which one is the new two, the top?
The top one.
The top one.
Okay.
Okay, so should we move down to B then?
And it does mention physician, just to be clear.
Yeah. Dennis, yeah, let's not go there, Mo.
Okay. Are we okay with the new two for now?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's go to B.
like these. What do you think, Dave? I think B is pretty good.
Yeah, I like B.
Dr. Baldwin?
Yeah, I think it's fine. I don't have any edit ideas, sorry.
Yeah. I mean, I was saying the only, like, again, debate, and that's not really our purview, is whether somebody else other than a physician is allowed to prescribe it. And I don't.
The only thing I would say about three, sorry, to go back up, is it says to reform, do we need to be more specific in three what the periodic office visits are? I mean, does that read the office visits with the dentist, office visit with the physician? Does it need to be more specific or not?
No.
I mean, the way I was reading it, it was specific to the dentist.
Yeah, me too. Because he's addressing the appliance.
Yeah. It's basically addressing the titration aspect of it.
Yeah.
Without saying that word.
I mean, the only thing, that kind of falls under follow-up and oversight care, right? You know, under two, shall provide follow-up and oversight care to ensure that dental-related complications are addressed as well as it is adequately addressing the obstructive sleep. I think it can be separated, rather than like using different language, though, could we should provide follow-up and oversight care to ensure that the obstructive sleep apnea, like, just keep the same language.
I guess I just didn't know if you guys wanted to include something to the effect of, because how do you know that the sleep apnea is being treated well? Usually you do follow-up studies, right? So then that.
I mean, maybe it could be should provide follow-up and oversight care to ensure the appliance is addressing the obstructive sleep apnea as intended with coordination with.
Right. I mean, because then it probably needs to go back, the dentist probably needs to refer the patient back to the sleep physician or whoever's kind of doing the follow-up or the follow-up treatment. And so I think the treatment piece is the part that needs to be done in collaboration, right?
Yeah, but the recommendations by those two associations were saying that follow-up and oversight is for the patient utilizing the oral appliance to ensure that dental-related side effects and occlusal changes are addressed. That was the first part of it. Then the second part of it is to return periodically to ensure it's addressing the OSA. That's, I think, where you should say something about the doctor then being consulted or brought in or whatever you want to say. Because the doctor's not going to make changes to the titration and the dental appliance.
Right, but I think then if the person is not, if the appliance itself is not adequately treating the OSA, right? So,
yes.
You know, in that moderate to severe where people are using the appliance, the moderate to severe, they might not be getting total resolution of their symptoms. Therefore, they could be developing pulmonary hypertension or something else.
So should we put that in paragraph 4?
I don't know. There should be probably something that says at some point the dentist needs to, you know, make sure the patient goes back to that physician to help monitor the sleep apnea.
I thought the sleep physician was quarterbacking the whole thing. That was the recommendation of Dr. Hickey, was that the sleep physician drove the bus. The dentist was just putting the appliance in.
No.
So is it on the dentist? Is it the dentist's responsibility to make the patient an appointment for a follow-up sleep study, or is that the sleep physician's job to make sure that they return for follow-up?
I think you could add to three. I think you could add to three is addressing the obstructive sleep apnea as intended by coordination with referring, you know, physician, referring medical provider, however you want to say it.
and to ensure appropriate adjustments, right? Because you would get a report from the physician that says, oh, no, they're still having X number of events, and you know, again, I don't know how to adjust these, but if the dentist determined that dentally it would be okay to further adjust the device, then they could do so. But it would have to be in coordination with the physician.
I agree.
What do you guys think about the way it's written now?
What?
What do you think about the way it's written now?
Why don't you just add what she said after OSA as intended?
Let me read it to you, sorry. It says a dentist shall instruct a patient with an oral appliance to return for periodic office visits to ensure the appliance is addressing the OSA as intended through coordination, collaboration with the treating physician to ensure appropriate adjustments. Once again, we're not defining what coordination and collaboration means, and that was the concern I was raising.
I mean, if you wanted to shorten it, you could, what about saying a dentist shall instruct a patient with an oral appliance to return for periodic office, dental, and medical visits to ensure the appliance is addressing the OSA as intended and to ensure appropriate adjustments. No, it's just a suggestion.
I'm not in favor of putting the onus on the dentist to make sure that there's medical follow-up. That's the treating physician's job to make sure that occurs.
Yeah, but the dentist is supposed to be doing that in coordination with the provider. I mean, that's what we've been saying all along.
Yeah, so the way we have it written right now is, you know, the dentist is making working effectively for dental needs, right? There's also making sure he or she is communicating with the physician and is not, you know, it's also addressing what has been diagnosed by the physician, right? But as Dave pointed out, it's not making the dentist schedule the patient's next physician visit or something like that.
Well, I just think I'm totally in favor of physician supervision of this whole process. I'm not in favor of burdening dentists with making sure the patient follows up with the physician. That's the physician's job. If they're going to quarterback that whole thing, they're responsible for follow-up polysomnography to make sure that the oral appliance is doing its job. The dentist doesn't control the physician's schedule. It shouldn't be liable for making that appointment.
Yeah, but don't you agree with the recommendations of those associations that said the dentist should tell the patient to come back periodically for visit?
I'll read it to you, Sue. It says, we suggest that sleep physicians conduct follow-up sleep testing to improve or confirm treatment efficacy rather than conduct follow-up without sleep testing for patients fitted with oral appliances.
And what I have is we suggest that sleep physicians and qualified dentists instruct adult patients treated with oral appliances for OSA to return for periodic office visits.
Agreed.
So it does include...
The office visit to the dentist's office is to address the occlusal changes, temporomandibular joint issues.
Right.
And if the sleep physician feels like it needs to be titrated more aggressively, that would be appropriate. But it's not the dentist's job to send the patient back to get his follow-up sleep study. That's the sleep physician's job to make sure they're coming back to their clinic.
That's not what this says. This just says you instruct them to return for periodic office visits. And then maybe what you don't want to take out is the part where it says to ensure the appliance is addressing the OSA as intended, because that's the doctor's purview, really. The dentist's purview is the appliance, right?
Right. I mean, I think like with anything, you know, if I'm seeing a patient for TMJ and their dentist is helping me, right, and they're helping with the treatment part, I can't make comments on the appliance that they're using. I say, you need to go back and see the dentist, right, to help them adjust it. And likewise, I would hope the dentist would say, well, gosh, if you're still having, you know, X, Y, and Z, you need to go back and see your doctor, because that's not in my scope or purview or whatever term you want to use. So I think similar type of language, we both have to work together to say, okay, you're using your appliance, but I don't see your sleep apnea getting better. You need to go back to your dentist to get it adjusted. And likewise, I would hope the dentist would say, gosh, you know, your appliance looks like it's adjusted well, but if you're still having sleep apnea symptoms, maybe you need to go back to your doctor.
Right.
Yeah, and I think three is basically saying that, just not in so many words, but maybe it's not clear enough. And Dave, I put in periodic dental office visits to make that part clear. And then Dr. Baldwin, we put in there, in addressing the OSA's intended through coordination and collaboration with the treating physician.
Yeah.
Because, yeah, they're both working on this together. The dentist is handling the dental aspects of it, and the physician's handling the medicine, and they're working together to figure out what works best for the patient. But is that clear enough in three?
Right. I think it's all about, you know, I mean, the onus is somewhat on the patient to say, you've got to go back and see them.
Yeah, I think it's okay.
And they're both telling each other, you got to go back to see them, right?
So leave it as I've got it modified to for now and sleep on it, that I'm hearing?
Yeah.
All right. C? Thoughts on C? Now, this is the education component, and I did ask Texas, just so you all know, where they got the 12 hours of basic education and the 3 hours of continuing education annually. And unfortunately, my counterpart and their attorney are both new and weren't around when the rule was created, so they didn't have that background. They said they would look into it, and if they can find out, let me know. But for now, I'm not sure how Texas came up with these requirements, but I just put them down here as a starting point, since it was the only place that I saw from a dental perspective where they actually listed out some education criteria that seemed reasonable to me. But as you heard from testimony, I think there's some folks that wanted to see more robust requirements.
I have no clue, so I don't know.
It exceeds the amount of training needed to place dental implants.
That wasn't helpful.
It doesn't matter what we put there. People are going to bitch about it anyway, so that seems reasonable to me.
Be careful. It's being recorded, sir. Yeah, it's a starting point. Yeah, I mean, what's that?
They're going to complain.
Yes, yes. I'm sure somebody, I mean, whatever, regardless of what you put down, somebody's going to have. Somebody will support it, and then somebody will not support it. But what we'll do is we'll share this working document with the stakeholders, you know, inform this is a working draft based on all the information we've received and discussion you guys have had, and then ask for more input. And so it'd be interesting to see how people react to that part of the rule. Draft rule. So just leave it for now, move on to D. Is that everybody okay with that?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think D addresses what you're trying to get at in B3.
I think you're right.
I think you're right. And I do think D is a little bit, it seems a little onus on the dentist. I think it shall inform and collaborate, but then also to discuss. But discuss needs another S if you keep it in there. Discuss and determine.
Not every patient he has. Just OSA patients.
I think it's fine to require the dentist to collaborate with the physician. I'm just not in favor of putting the onus on the dentist to make sure that the patient follows up. That's between the patient and the sleep physician.
Right. I mean, I guess, what is the intent of this? Is the intent, Dave, that you would send me an office note?
You could say, hey, I saw Joe patient, Mr. Smith, for titration of his oral appliance. We've titrated it 7 millimeters. That's the limit of his comfort. Please perform repeat polysomnography to address the efficacy of the mandibular advancement device.
Okay. I mean, that's what you're reading out of what that is.
Call up and make the appointment for the patient or anything like that, or to ensure that the patient gets back there.
No, and you know, if you send me a letter that says that, it's just like me receiving anything else. It's then the onus on me to schedule the follow-up with the patient.
Correct. But the way the rule reads now, it says the dentist shall instruct the patient to return for it. It seems to me that that puts the onus on the durable medical equipment provider to make sure that the patient's following up with the sleep physician.
So what if number three just says a dentist shall instruct, I mean, because the way that I read this number three is just that the dentist's responsibility to make sure that they follow up with their own patient on their appliance to make sure you're right. Doing what you can to maximize the treatment.
But I think that's in two, isn't it?
No, that's different.
Yeah, I can't see two right now, but I think that talks about occlusal changes. Yeah.
So then should three just go away? Yeah. Because then you addressed in D what you wanted to do as far as the collaboration part of it.
Correct. I actually like the way D reads better than three.
Okay. Would it make sense to put part of three under two? You know, the dentist should provide follow-up and oversight care related to dental complications as well as ensure the appliance is addressing obstructive sleep apnea as intended through coordination and collaboration with the treating physician. Just make it all under two. That basically, we want the dentist to follow up and make sure the device is working as best as it can, pre-coordinating with the physician as well as managing the dental complications that may come with the device. But
I just don't understand what the collaboration does more than what it says in D.
Right. No, I agree. I mean, I think D addresses a lot of what three does. I think three was also saying we don't want the dentist to, like, make the device, say, okay, well, we've managed the dental complications and then never follow up again as to, okay, well, did you check in with your physician? How is this working? Do we need to adjust things? I mean, we want the dentist. I think three is saying that the dentist needs to follow up both aspects of the care, and D is also saying that the dentist needs to coordinate with the physician. I mean, maybe D could be rolled up.
I mean, how much would be lost if we just took out three, knowing that what we've seen two and knowing what we've seen D? Do you think we lose anything?
I don't know that the dentist is the one that can even determine if the appliance is addressing the sleep apnea, because that's determined by follow-up polysomnography. And if he was ensuring that, he would be treating and working outside of the scope of dentistry.
And wouldn't D cover that?
I think so.
Okay.
What if we took out three and then added to D something about, you know, shall inform and collaborate with prescribing physician regarding ongoing treatment and, you know, see the, I mean, not necessarily this language exactly, but basically see the patient for follow-up as needed regarding the treatment of the OSA. Just put, you know, add something like that to D.
As far as responsibility goes, the dentist is only responsible for oversight of occlusal changes and any side effects from the appliance. The sleep physician's the one that's responsible to make sure that the sleep apnea is being adequately treated.
I agree with Dave.
You can't have it both ways. You can't not allow dentists to diagnose and treat independently and then turn around and say, but you're responsible to make sure that this is treating it. It can't be that way.
So are we deleting three?
Yes, we've deleted three and kept D as it is. Okay. As is. You guys okay with that for now?
Doctor? I'm fine with it.
Dave, you good?
Yeah, I like it better without three.
Okay. So F or E, sorry. And my alphabet. It's been a long day. All right, we're on E.
Any comments, questions, concerns about E?
The only thing I would say is that are we introducing something new?
Yes.
Are we talking about snoring as related to OSA, or are we just talking about snoring all by itself?
Just snoring was what the testimony was about. We have lots of patients who come in and say they're just snoring and they want help.
Yeah, that's tricky because snoring's one of the hallmarks of obstructive sleep apnea. But you can have primary snoring and not have obstructive sleep apnea.
Exactly, which is why it says according to the standard of care.
I think E does address that basically if the patient says they're snoring, you should screen for sleep apnea. Make sure that the physician rules out sleep apnea and says, yeah, this is snoring only. A device is fine, right? I kind of think that's what he says in more professional terms.
Thoughts?
I'm not sure what the efficacy of a mandibular advancement device is for snoring.
So are you saying that it may be misleading the way it's presented?
It's muddy.
Muddy?
Seems unclear.
Would you suggest taking it out or modifying it?
I think you need to address snoring in some way because there were a lot of people that testified about it at the previous hearing. If you just take it out, then they're going to say that every single snoring has to go through the whole process. Does it? I mean, is that the standard of care?
But I think we're talking very specifically about OSA, though, aren't we? We're not talking about snoring.
Correct, but it's come up in the discussion of OSA a few
people
times.
People want to know what their obligation is.
Shall we take it out for now and see how people react to it? Think anyone will miss it?
I just think we're talking about the diagnosis, treatment, scope around OSA and not just snoring all by itself.
I do think some of the testimony was concerned that if we say only OSA, that we would somehow be limiting people who want to manufacture devices for snoring when OSA is not at issue.
Yes.
Which I think is why it was in there.
So is snoring, though, a totally different topic?
Well, so is orthodontia, and so is oral and maxillofacial.
Right.
I mean, we're just trying to define for them what the parameters are.
Yeah, I mean, the other thing we could do is those thoughts about, you know, helping educate on snoring and educate on other aspects maybybe related to sleep apnea could be addressed in the policy. And perhaps the rule is not the best place for it. So just something to think about, too. So the idea with it, to have a discussion about it, that's why these three points are in here at the end. But this might not be the best place for them.
Well, and sometimes in a rule, don't you write things like, this does not include the treatment of snoring without sleep apnea?
Correct, and we could do that up.
Like up at the front, up at the top, this rule doesn't address the treatment of snoring with appliances without sleep apnea, or I don't know.
I like that approach. I still like it down in whatever letter we're on, G or H or whatever it is.
And E.
Okay. I mean, I think if it makes sense to you, Dave.
How about if we put some, a dentist may also address snoring in the absence of obstructive sleep apnea.
Yeah, I mean, I think if you think that's appropriate at this point, at this place, I think, and if that addresses people's concerns.
I think so. That way it puts the onus on them to make sure that the patient's snoring is not a warning sign that's and they've got underlying sleep apnea,
right,
if it's primary snoring and they've been, you know, screened or sleep apnea has been ruled out, then they shouldn't need to collaborate with a physician to make an appliance for that.
Right, so you should be able to take out that second sentence, right?
Yes.
We reflect the language from FRG that nothing is ruled.
I didn't hear that last comment.
Great, I was saying, should we reflect the language from FRG that nothing this rule shall prevent a dentist from addressing snoring in the absence of obstructive sleep apnea?
I was not reading below where we were at, so yes, I think that sounds good.
Yeah, that's fine.
I think you should put treating in there, address or prevent a dentist from treating snoring in the absence of obstructive sleep apnea.
Yeah, that's more consistent with the second, with the F too. Did you want to say treating snoring or treating a patient with snoring?
Yeah, I think you could put treating a patient with snoring in the absence of obstructive sleep apnea.
Do you want to add the standard of care stuff that you have in F? No?
I don't know that there's... you could reference something consistent with the guidelines of AASM and AADSM if you wanted to.
I was just thinking you could say the nomenclature could be the same. Like you could say nothing in this rule shall prevent a dentist from treating a patient according to the standard of care for snoring in the absence of OSA. I don't know if you wanted to use the same language in F that you need in the E or if you don't need it. I just don't know.
Yeah, I'm not familiar with what the standard of care for snoring is. I think the in my mind the key thing in E is to make sure that if they're treating snoring, that the patient also doesn't have obstructive sleep apnea. If they've established that the patient is just snoring and doesn't have sleep apnea, then they should be able to treat that patient independently.
So do you need that second sentence like F does? Or, I mean, I like how E states it's pretty clean.
It's a specialty, more or less, orthodontia.
I like E. It's clear.
I'm just not sure if snoring is, in and of itself, has a standard of care like orthodontics or oral and maxillofacial surgery. There's pretty clear guidelines in the AMIS parameters on what and how sleep apnea is treated surgically.
Okay.
I mean, we could leave it in there and see if anybody objects to it. I think it's implied that if you're treating somebody, you're treating them to the standard of care.
I believe that is, yes, that's actually implied in everything that you do.
Right. I didn't put F in there, so I don't know where that came from, but
yeah, there was the
standard of care.
The orthodontia thing was, it was the older gentleman Calder, some of them. Calendar, thank you.
Yeah, I don't disagree that orthodontists should be allowed to modify growth. I mean, they serve an important role in, you know, widening the nasal airway. There is evidence that growth modification can address sleep apnea in the pediatric population.
So leave E. Do we transition to F? Oh, we are on
EF.
I think F and G look fine.
Okay.
But I'd leave that to Dave or...
I don't know what the standard of care for orthodontia is as it relates to sleep apnea.
The only comment I had with G, I'm not trying to pick a fight with you, Dave, but I just want to see how you react to this.
Don't even start with me, Mo.
It is G, should it say, nothing in this rule should prevent a dentist from providing surgical treatment to a patient with obstructive sleep apnea in accordance with the blah, 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 the rest of it. So instead of saying an oral and maxillofacial surgeon, saying a dentist. What are your thoughts on that?
How about nothing in this rule shall prevent a dentist from providing oral and maxillofacial surgery treatment to a patient?
I like it.
I see what you're saying there, though. That makes sense.
What do you think now? I'm sure I've got
time. Yeah, that's fine. I mean, I would argue that not even every oral and maxillofacial surgeon is appropriately trained for that type of procedure.
Good point.
I think that's fine.
Okay. Cool. My gosh, we're through one page of this. Thank God it's not 17 pages like the anesthesia rule. And so you guys are comfortable with E, F, and G being in the rule, as opposed to some of the comments I made earlier about potentially taking them out and putting them in a policy for education? I mean, it is. I do like it in the rule because it's telling them right then and there what they, you know, how it impacts them. But any thoughts on that? Are you guys comfortable with this working draft as is? Give it some more review and thought until the next meeting on Monday, and I'm sure we'll get a plethora of stakeholder comment and response to it for you to consider as well.
I think it's pretty clean too. My request from the stakeholders is to come up with language suggestions versus just comments.
Exactly.
So that it's easier for us to.
Exactly. If there's something you don't like about it or choose to modify, provide proposed language. I'm going to provide them with the draft and say, just provide your feedback in this format, right? Red line preferably.
Correct.
As you would like to see it. And then also, if you do make changes, if you could provide the supporting document to support a proposed change, that would be helpful as well.
I agree. I think we've heard a lot of anecdotal evidence, but I haven't heard a lot of scientific evidence presented, particularly from the dental community, as far as why they feel that this shouldn't be enacted or anything to support their position. I think if they're going to disagree or have an issue with the way it's written, they should provide an appropriate modification to the rule.
I think that's fair. Any other comments? I lied to you. It's well past 6, but it is before 7, so you did beat the last meeting. So we're definitely having the meeting. It sounds like we have to have one more meeting to review this draft, as well as stakeholder feedback and response to the draft. And so that's scheduled for next Monday at 4 p.m. in 110 B as in David again. And of course, we'll be sending out a new link to you guys and anyone else that wants to participate via webinar again. That is a wrap. Thank you all. Have a good night.
Thank you, Mo. Thanks, everybody.